What's up, guys? Awakened Gaming here again. So today we are going to be doing part 3 of our Hack the Box series. So we're actually going to get into some hacking today. We're going to be doing the box called Blue. And if you want to go ahead and start up your Kali Linux machine, and then we will be navigating over to Hack the Box. And I thought that we could start with the most easily rated boxes and then work our way up, so that way the people that know absolutely nothing about Linux or Hack the Box can kind of get a feel for how we do things using easier boxes, so that way once we get into more difficult boxes, it'll be a lot easier for them to follow along with us. So go ahead and log in. And if you missed how to set up Kali Linux, you might want to go back and check those out. Or if you did not see how we set up our VPN connections and all that stuff, and getting into Hack the Box itself, you might want to go check those out. There's 2 previous videos in this series. I highly suggest going and checking those out before we get into it anymore, so that way you guys can see how we're all set up. So let's start up our VPN connection. So CD to where we downloaded your file. So mine would be in downloads. And then we will open VPN and then your username. And then .ovpn. And you should see at the end of it, initialization sequence complete. We'll right click here and move that to another workspace. Now let's go to Hack the Box. So that'll be hackthebox.eu. And then we'll come down here to machines, all. And then HackBox does not allow us to do machines that are active. We're not allowed to do write-ups for active machines, only retired machines. So that's the ones we're going to be doing. And if we show our filters to user rated difficulty, ascending, and uncheck all of these, you'll see blue at the top here. And as you can see, the difficulty is extremely easy. And as we go down, they start to turn to all reds. So those are the more difficult boxes. And if we go in here, we can click in. We can see the IP address here, the name of it. It's going to be running Windows. And we see the IP address again, and we get a little matrix here. So this is rather close to real life. It's mostly CVE, meaning that there is a exploit that someone found for this. A little tiny bit of enumeration, ever so slightly CTF-like, and there will be no custom exploitation involved. So as you can see, I've already owned this box. We can go ahead and get into an nmap. So nmap, and I'm going to do a dash H. So that way we can see all of our options here. And for most boxes, we'll be using the same nmap commands. So for this, we will do dash S capital C dash S dash S capital C. So let me find those options right quick. Dash S capital V probes open ports to determine service and version info. So it'll determine what service is running on the port and the version information for that service. And then if we scroll down slightly, the SC runs default scripts, meaning is basically the safe scripts that will not cause the server to crash or hang anything up on the server. So we can nmap dash S capital C dash S capital V, and then our IP address, which was 10.10.10.40. We press enter on that, and that will go ahead and fire away. And then we can navigate back here, and sometimes there's a website attached to these machines. So if we type in our IP address, 10.10.10.40, we can check that out, and there does not appear to be. So we will just have to wait for our nmap scan to complete. And while that's going on, I explain a little bit more of what all this stuff is. So we can see the name of the box that we're doing, and we can see that it is Windows. That's how many points you would have gotten when this box was in the active box list. This is how many people have owned the box as administrator. This is how many own the user on the server. And here we can go into own user and own root. Once we have those flags, we could reset the machine. We can extend the machine's time. We can terminate the machine, check the status of the machine. Info card, that just brings up all of the same stuff in a slightly easier to read format. And then we can rate this. This is the graph of green is users. Blue is users, green is root. So we can see the kind of infograph of how long it took people to kind of get this, and then now that it's been so long, not that many people are rooting it anymore. And then we can see how many people had to reset this machine. So if you see this red line way up above everything else, that means that the box is prone to crashing, but this one is pretty low, so we shouldn't have that problem. We can see who created the machine, and if we click on them, we can see their profile, get a little bit more information about the person that actually created this box. And here we can see the user difficulty graph broken down for us a little bit. Most people said this was extraordinarily easy, which it is. This is how many points you'll get now if you complete it, which is 0 since it's a retired machine. And this is how long the box has been active for. We can go and do an official write-up. Let's see the official write-up for the box. And here's the difficulty of completing each. The user and the root as well. Most people say that is extraordinarily easy. And that's pretty much it. This should be completed, which it is. So here we can see that the scan took about, where is it at? I think it's at the end. We can see all the open ports here, which there are quite a few. We have a lot of RCP servers. Here we can see that we have a SMB server and a NetBIOS server as well. And running those safe scripts tells us that we have a clock skew of almost a minute. We have SMB OS discovery, so it's telling us that we have Windows 7 Professional Service Pack 1. And here that kind of confirms it for us. The computer's name, and then the NetBIOS computer name. The 0x is null byte, meaning that it doesn't have any information there. What the system's time is. And here we see we have SMB security mode, account used as guest, authentication level is user, security mode is 2.02, message signing enabled but not required, and SMB2 time. So with this being a Windows 7 Professional server, or machine rather, and gathering a little bit of contextual information from the box being called Blue, we can deduce that this is most likely prone to the Eternal Blue exploit. So if we go to MSF DB start, we can start up the MFS database, and then we can MFS console You could just type in msfconsole and not worry about starting the database first, but I like to start the database first so that way it's got the database already open when MSF opens, so that way it can read everything from the console straight away without having it. Just makes it, if you need to search for anything, a little bit quicker because it's already got the database indexed for you. And the exploit we are looking for, which is Eternal Blue, we're pretty sure that will work, so we use exploit, and it's under Windows, SMB, and it's Microsoft 17.0.10 Eternal Blue. Oop, misspelled. Microsoft 17.0.10 Eternal Blue. If I can type, please. Eternal Blue. So then we'll show options, and we can see here we need to set our host, which will be the 10.10.10.40. So set our hosts 10.10.10.40 and show options again. And we have the R port, which we can confirm up here that that is the correct R port. That's the correct remote port. Yeah, that was our SMB port, so that is correct. And then the rest of this doesn't matter. So we can press exploit, and this should fire away. It's going to set up a reverse TCP handler for us, and then it's going to use this auxiliary scanner to scan to make sure that this is vulnerable, and it says that it most likely is, which we already kind of knew, but it does just double checks for us. And then it connects to the target and verifies the OS using an SMB reply, and then it does a core raw buffer dump, so it tries to dump some memory to indicate yes, it is Windows 7. And then it selects the target for as Windows 7, and then it tries this, the 12 groom allocation, or yeah, allocations. So basically it's just trying to do a buffer overload, and it does it in a staged, so it sends part of it, has it connect back to us, and then uses that connection to send the rest of it through. And now it's trying to receive the response from the exploit, which might take a couple of minutes. And as we can see, it successfully completed. And we've got a shell open on session one. So if we type who am I, we should get a response. So who am I? We can see that we are authority. And if we ifconfig our pconfig, because we're on Windows, we can see that we are indeed on our box. So then we can cd back to the root folder, dir, because we're on Windows, and we can cd into users, dir again. We can see that we have two interesting directories, administrator and Harris. So we'll cd into Harris, dir again. We can cd into desktop, dir again, and we see we get our users.txt. I'm not going to spoil the surprise for you for what the flag is, just know that that is the correct place for the flag. We cd ../ again, we can dir and then cd into administrator. DIR, CD into desktop again, And we see that we get the root.txt. You type less and then the file. And then you would own them. And that's pretty much it. So yeah, this is an extremely easy box. I apologize if you thought that there was going to be a little bit more hackery involved here. But remember, we're starting from the easiest boxes and going up to more difficult boxes, so that way you guys can kind of get a little bit more of a grasp on what the steps for an actual penetration test would be. So if you did like this content, there's definitely going to be a lot more of it. So if you would please subscribe and hit the notification bell, so that way you are alerted when I upload a new video. That would be awesome. Thank you guys so much for taking time out of your day to spend with me. And I will see you guys in the next video.